I was talking about that. But yeah, Chiefs beat the Eagles in a Super Bowl. Two black quarterbacks facing one another. Black History Month, you know, history in the making. They say the Mahomes, the name Patrick Mahomes, the Chiefs guy is like actually really good is what they're saying.
And one of the highest scoring Super Bowls ever, and it came down to the wire.
It was a nail biter. Fans in Kansas City.
It was a real barn burner. It's all scripted. Who cares, bro? Okay. Obviously, it's so scripted. I didn't even watch it, and even I knew it was scripted. It was just so scripted.
Interrupted, of course, celebration into the game. City skyline turned red. From the fireworks, see you right there.
And Michael was there for it all, shining bright like a diamond, as he always does. How was it, Michael?
Oh, Rebecca, it was amazing. What a night it was. What a halftime show. And, of course, what a comeback. The Kansas City Chiefs, they were down. But in the end, they overcame the Philadelphia Eagles with just seconds left. You see the field goal right there. And our Will Reed, Will was at the game with me also last night. He's at the stadium. With all the excitement, good morning to you, Will.
Good morning, Michael. Would have loved to have been at the game actually with you. You had some great seats. And there's no way that that game could have lived up to all the hype with such two evenly matched and elite teams, right? Well, it did, especially those two quarterbacks who made history just by playing against each other. And then they went out and broke records and added to their legacies. This game had it all. And the Chiefs have another Super Bowl.
This morning, the Kansas City Chiefs are waking up Super Bowl champions.
The Kansas City Chiefs have won Super Bowl 57!
Winning their second title in 4 years after an epic battle against the Philadelphia Eagles that lived up to the hype.
Mahomes firing, it is caught by Kelce in stride.
The showdown between the NFL...
This is the first time I'm watching it. I had no fucking clue what was going on. I don't really care. I'm on the fuck Philly train in general usually, like... but I feel bad. Like I feel it doesn't feel good. It doesn't feel good to lose. So I'm on, normally I'd be on the fuck Philly train, but right now I'm on the refs are fucking cheating train. I don't know anything about football. I didn't even watch the game, but from what I understand, the script went crazy. There was an improper call from the refs last minute and the game ended with a kick. I mean, You hate to see it, Philadelphia. They fucked you over again.
Those two best teams, led by superstar quarterbacks shining bright on the biggest stage.
He has a seam, and Jalen Hurts is in for the touchdown.
MVP runner-up Jalen Hurts setting a Super Bowl QB record with three rushing touchdowns, including this one on the game's opening drive.
And another opening drive for a touchdown for Philly.
Not to be outdone, this year's MVP, Patrick Mahomes, coming right back to tie it with this touchdown to Travis Kelce.
Kelce got it! Touchdown!
Who made history by playing against his brother, Jason. The first time brothers have faced off in the Super Bowl.
Oh, what a trio that is.
Philly fans can suck at the biggest whiners in sports. They could have all have their pro teams win their respective championships in the same year and still be crying in the offseason about trades and shit. I mean, that's just like... I feel like that's just basic Philadelphia behavior in general, though. They have to live in Philadelphia, like, which makes sense. This was very cute, by the way. This was so incredibly cute. I'm such a sucker for, like, dumb shit like this. But I saw that post that she posted on Twitter with the fit, and immediately I was like, oh, that's so wonderful. You know what I mean? She wins anyway, no matter what happens, which is so cool.
Mom, Donna, seen taking it all in next to Commissioner Roger Goodell and Buffalo Bills safety DeMar Hamlin.
He's got it! Touchdown!
The Eagles leading the Chiefs through the first half as the teams traded touchdowns on a slippery field.
Well, look at the pile of cleats there.
Hurts changing cleats midway through the game, his teammate falling on this kickoff.
Elliott was lucky to get that off.
Man, he's lucky he didn't twist his ankle.
In the second quarter, Mahomes appearing to tweak his injured ankle, but he played through the pain.
Throws on the run and has a completion and a first down.
In the first ever Super Bowl matchup between two black starting quarterbacks, Mahomes and Hurts putting on a show in an instant classic.
Touchdown, Kansas City!
The Chiefs taking the lead for the first time in the fourth quarter, but Hurts bringing the Eagles back to tie it on this gutsy touchdown and two-point conversion.
There he's in! We're tied at Super Bowl 57!
With the score tied...
I don't understand one thing. Like, someone can correct me. This is a serious question. Please don't yell at me. Bro, How the fuck? Okay. How the fucking fuck? By the way, thank you, Central Committee, for the raid. You know, Mike from Pennsylvania. Sorry for, you know, sorry for the Eagles losing. I don't know. You're a Steelers fan, right? Probably. But regardless, you know, still a blow to Pennsylvania, you know, in general. So anyway, don't yell at me, but how the fuck do they mess up the field conditions this bad? I genuinely do not understand. Like, it's not, brother, it's for the Super Bowl. You know what I mean? You knew that it was going to happen. You knew that it was going to happen for like a while. You know, it happens every year. We knew that it was going to be in Arizona. It's not like a particularly wet climate. How the fuck? Like, how do you fuck this up? You have one job. Arizona, you had one fucking job, dude. Count the votes in time and figure out the turf. How does Arizona always just demonstrate their failure, their inability to deal with, like, simple tasks that they are given? You go to Arizona, you're like, all right, well, there's an election. Let's see what fucking happens. Like, Arizona's like, sorry, 8 months down the line, we're still recounting. We're still counting, sorry. Dropping the ball every step of the way. I don't understand it. Don't blame Arizona this time. It was some guys thinking they were smart and they engineered a new breed of grass for the Super Bowl. Yeah. The NFL spent 2 years preparing the grass for tonight's field of the Super Bowl. The grass was grown from local sod farm in Phoenix. It was installed 2 weeks ago, and the field has been rolled out each morning for daily sunshine. Total cost $800,000. The grass sits on a 40-inch deep tray that measures 234 feet wide and 403 feet long. The field travels 740 feet when it goes inside and outside the stadium. The entire process takes about an hour. Las Vegas is the only other NFL stadium with a similar tech. Here's how it looks like in Phoenix and Las Vegas, respectively. If you're learning about this type of stuff, you should sign up for my newsletter. The real Super Bowl MVP tonight is George Toma. He's 94 years old, and he's been the groundskeeper for Athletics, Royals, and Chiefs. He's prepared the fields for 37 Pro Bowls, several World Series, every single Super Bowl in history. His nickname, the Sod Father. Bro, okay, I'm going to be honest. Maybe it's time to retire. I'm just saying, you're 94. Just retire at that point, right? I mean, he looks pretty great for 94. Yeah, I guess. But, like, you know, fucking turf, people playing Super Bowl 57, people boycotting the Harry Potter game. Yeah, true. Giants have a 95-year-old trainer that was there since World War II. I'm just saying, you know, figure this shit out, I think, right? Like, am I crazy? Like, how do you fuck this up? How do you fuck this up? This is the one job you got. And they fucked it up. They boofed it. And it makes no goddamn sense. It's like forgetting to run the top of the hour ad break and then running it 7 minutes in. You know, I have one fucking job. I'm not here to deliver the news. I'm not here to do anything. I'm not here to do politics. I'm here to fucking serve you top of the hour ad breaks. 3 minutes long at the top of every hour. Okay? And if you no longer want to see those ads, all you need to do is subscribe, which you can do for $5 or for free with Twitch Prime by connecting your Amazon Prime account to your Twitch account, where you get one free Prime subscription a month. You can also get gifted a sub if you're lucky. That's another way to avoid the top of the hour ad breaks as well. Here's a 3-minute ad break now. You know? Wild clip from the post game. Yeah, I don't know. We'll look at the ads too. We'll look at the commercials on the Super Bowl.
Also, of course, two African American quarterbacks starting against each other in the Super Bowl for the first time. Fittingly, February 12th is Abe Lincoln's birthday. Here we go with the highlights in case you missed.
What? Dude, yo, I love white people so much, dude. It's fucking fire. Yeah. You know what's really cool about black guys doing cool shit? You know what's really cool about black accomplishments? A white guy. It's like, it's so funny, dude. Jesus Christ. He said fittingly. Anyway. Yeah, what's really cool about these two black quarterbacks facing one another on Black History Month is a white guy's birthday. Yeah. He's basically saying, thanks for the Super Bowl, Abe. Yeah, no, but that's awesome. That's so awesome. That's such an awesome fucking take. Because, like, you know, in his mind, he was cooking this one up, and he thought, you know, in his mind, he thought this is like a woke thing to say. You know what I mean? Because like he's from an era where you didn't get fired for saying like, black people are just genetically more athletic, you know, shit like that. He survived that wave when, what's the guy? What was it, Greek? What the fuck was that dude who got fired for saying it? And a whole bunch of other racist shit. Jimmy the Greek. Yeah, like, he survived that wave of firings. So, this is, you know, because he's woke in comparison to other shit. Which, by the way, the whole concept behind, like, black guys make athletic plays, white guys make intelligent plays, like, that literally still exists. Like, that narrative is still very prominent in both NFL commentary and NFL watchers in general. Anyway, let's move away from this. Somebody photoshopped a star of David onto Rihanna's outfit, and some conservatives are freaking out that she was exposing America to Satanism. How will the masses know we're worshiping Satan? Easy. We're going to put a pentagram on our devil suit. The blurry image appears to show six-pointed star. Pentagrams have 5 points. But, okay. But, like, even if it was a fucking pentagram, like, who gives a what the fuck? Dude, people are fucking so insane, brother. That, I mean, it's cool. I've talked about this already. I mean, they're basically, we are officially medieval peasants. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is medieval peasant shit. Straight up. It's awesome. It's great. This has 14,000 likes, man. The internet is so fire that, like, the guy who normally you would, like, avoid at the fucking subway station who's screaming at you about, like, you know, baby-eating, Satan-worshipping pedophiles is now getting 14,000 likes because there's all the other 14,000 psychopaths like that guy can all congregate on Twitter and be like, no, you're so smart. Thank you for this. And yeah, exactly. There's also the Zoomer coalition of this too. Zoomers who are into satanic panic kicked off by post-Astroworld TikTok need to unplug. I love it, dude, for the record. This is awesome. No, I love living in a completely different plane of existence. And there are plenty of people like this. There are, like, normal people who have these kinds of opinions. Dude, there's videos on TikTok with 100K likes of some dude saying there's two moons. Yeah. You've seen the QRTs on this one? What? Why? Oh, people don't believe it because the baby didn't have a scratch on him? Is that what they're saying? They're saying that the baby is fake? This is a fake baby that they pulled out of the rubble because it... They're saying that the baby is fake. TikTok is the lead poisoning of the future. Who's gonna take care of the victims? No, we're... Philly Mongoast, thank you for the 10 gifted subs. Allowing 10 people to no longer see the ads at the top of the hour. They're saying it's a fake baby. Like, it's a real baby that they placed him in there for a feel-good story. Because he doesn't have a scratch on him, apparently. Not understanding that, a baby is tiny. So, could technically just, fit in a crevice. You know what I mean? Insane people shit. Damar Hamlin's jacket you saw was made by the artist Takashi Murakami. Is actually titled Travis Jesus. Travis Scott sacrifices fans in a satanic ritual at Asher World. He made that feast famous. He made that piece famous by commissioning a jeweler to turn the image into a large rhinestone encrusted pendant. So are they saying Damar Hamlin is also, he's also satanic? Eden Ross's unmodded kick chat yesterday was spamming L Demons during the halftime show. Limafail. Dude, it's awesome. I'm glad that the Zoomers are just as brain broken as the generation before, especially because, when you're young, you never want to be like your parents, right? Like, social media platforms are only cool as long as, older generations don't actually start using the social media platforms, things like that. Philomongos, thank you for the another 10 gifted subs. And I find it really funny that they're just, repeating the same shit that their parents and their great-grandparents repeated right now. It's great. It's cool. Zoomers are so fucking stupid, dude. Just like every other goddamn generation. It's awesome. The satanic talk and entertainment in general has been around for years now. Yeah, of course. It's always been around. But due to TikTok, woke... TikTok is up Philly's ass already.
So this is a bunch of white Eagles fans in
Philly. I mean, this is a cliche at this point. But yeah, it's true for the record. I mean, we're just forced to relive the same media cycle every fucking year. I think we're in purgatory. We're not in hell. We're just in purgatory waiting to go to hell, I think. And when we die, we end up going to hell. Because we're just reliving the same shit over and over again. Like, I've had this exact same news cycle and this exact same conversation a million times over. And it is true. It's still true. When, yes, Philly fans fucking burn the city down, it's expected. It's understandable. Everyone's, doing a little stress relief. When it's, black people doing it because a black person was murdered in the hands of the police, then it's, they're getting rowdy. They're demons, they're animals, blah, 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 blah. Whatever the kind of fucking freak-ass, racist-ass narrative the media can cook. You know what I mean? It's always the same. I've said this. I've said these words before.
So this is a bunch of white Eagles fans in Philadelphia flipping a car, causing a riot before the Super Bowl. Can you imagine for a second black or brown people doing something like this? The amount of privilege is staggering. This is bananas.
Anyway, I don't know if it was a TikTok thing. Satanic panic in the South has been a thing my whole life when it comes to Protestants. No. Satanic panic has always been a thing. Okay. The term satanic panic comes from the mass induced hysteria that was pumped up by mainstream media in the 80s and 90s. So it's always in different versions of that also existed prior to that as well. But the term comes, I think, like from the 80s and 90s, right? Regardless, though, there's a different flavor of that for every generation. But my point is, like, with the invention of the internet and how readily available the internet is and how readily available social media is to every single person, instead of going in the opposite direction of like being of having a conversation about how silly this shit is, everyone is basically reinforcing the same cycle of misinformation and hysteria, because now they're gaining clout individually from doing it, because there's just as many fucking psychopaths out there who believe this shit and want more. They want to be fed with this like kind of misinformation. So that's it. We're just kind of doing the same thing over and over again. There is, I guess Rihanna played a Kanye song during the halftime, Super Bowl halftime show, which people were mad at too. Anyway, so yeah, there's a lot of Super Bowl drama. We talked about the referee here. We'll talk about the referees in a second, and then we'll get to some other shit.
On that ankle, and this crucial and controversial penalty on the Eagles, setting the Chiefs up to win it on a field goal.
Let's run that back. Hold on. Oh, fuck. Got it. Dude.
Set run on that ankle. And this crucial and controversial penalty on the Eagles, setting the Chiefs up to win it on a...
So that's not allowed, right? Like, that's considered a hold?
Controversial penalty on the
right
Eagles.
Right here, that's considered a hold, and that's, like, not allowed, right? The player himself has come out and said that he held. Now, of course, the reason why he came out and said that he held is because... It's because it's a script. It's scripted. He was scripted to say that he held it. Okay? I'm here to tell you the truth. Like, you want to know the truth? I'll tell you the fucking truth, okay? That's right. He didn't actually hold.
This crucial and controversial penalty.
He didn't hold hard enough.
Setting the Chiefs up to win it on a field goal.
He had to keep up the act.
Through the uprights and into.
It was barely a hold, which isn't a problem with it getting called. The problem is that things like that hadn't been called all game, and then the players play to how the game is being called, and a major shift like this in the last couple of minutes is an issue.
History. The Chiefs champions.
How does it compare kicking the game-winning, Super Bowl-winning field goal to what you dreamed of as a kid when you were growing up?
Yeah, I mean, that's what you dream of as a kicker, you know, getting to the Super Bowl and have a game-winning kick. It's an amazing feeling.
The Kelce brothers embracing amid the confetti.
Travis, what'd you say to your brother in the hug with the confetti?
There's nothing you can really say to a loved one in a situation like that. It's a weird feeling. There's nothing really I could say to him other than I love him, and he played a hell of a year, a hell of a season.
Mahomes winning his second Super Bowl and second Super Bowl MVP.
He's the MVP. I mean, that's all that needs to be said, right? MVP. And he saw it tonight.
To be down to a team like that and to come back and win the game, I wish I'd make it easier and not be down, but I feel like I play better when we are down.
The Chiefs and their fans erupting in celebration.
You gotta fight for your right!
Patrick Mahomes has been a starting QB for 5 seasons now, and he already has a case for the Hall of Fame. And he added to that resume last night, becoming the first.
That's fucking crazy. Apparently, he already was like working off an ankle injury. Is that true? Or a wrist injury or something? So he was zooted the entire time, too, on top of that. Man, they're going to fucking. I hope they don't burn him into the ground, dude. Holy shit. I mean, it's cool. I love that. He played with high ankle sprain. Oh, okay. He has a 10-year contract. He's going to be a nub when he's done. Yeah, they're going to fucking grind him down, dude. Which, you know, during halftime, they gave him that good Zaza. I wonder what they do in that situation. What do they, like, give you? They just pump you full of shit. What that chatter said was bullshit. The Chiefs would have won anyway because the ref said one of their TDs didn't count. Eagles fans going ape shit after the loss. Oh, I saw this. He said, fuck no, it's not just a game. Toradol, that's what it's called? Yo, I need me some of that. Why would this be fake? It's got a sticker on it. The TV still has a sticker on it, implying that like they might have just bought it just to break it. You know what I mean? That kind of thing. I do love the idea of the Eagles fans in the chat are trying to like get ahead. Philadelphia people in the chat are trying to get ahead of the memes by being like, it's fake, actually. I heard that it's fake. That's not, that guy's actually a Chiefs fan, really. That's really silly that you guys are saying it's real. It's not, clearly. Also, Philadelphia, totally fine. No riots happened. That's also fake. How about we don't talk about that, you know? The aliens, UFOs. Nah, my brown parents love keeping stickers on products. Well, I don't know if I fucked your mom and I'm now your stepdad, but I am your brown parent then because I also love keeping stickers on products. It's true. This is a sad Eagles big boy.
Sticking Cowboys.
You're crying.
I'm hurt. I love my Eagles. I don't believe it.
You going to flap the hat one more time for the Eagles for the hard fight they did?
Let's go, birds fly, eagles fly.
Yo, straight up, this is my favorite part about football, dude. I love this shit. I fucking love this shit, dude. It's not even, dude. That's so good. Look at how sad the flap is.
Eagles with a hard fight.
Womp, womp.
Let's go, birds fly, eagles fly.
This dude is talking like he lost a loved one. Dude, if you have nothing in your life, then this is like a loved one. I get it. That's why people care about their content and their consumption so much. That's why people have so much of an insane association with their consumption, with what they identify with. This goes along with everything that I've talked about. Whether it be jalapeno poppers at Applebee's, whether it be the guns that people identify with as like, you know, they're not just the product that they use, but also like a lifestyle. Same with the fucking Eagles. You know what I mean? It's just, they're sports fans. They got nothing else going on in their lives to root for. What else are they going to root for? They root for their teams. I get it. Like, I understand it. Same with fucking Harry Potter. You grow up watching a team as a kid and you become super invested. Yeah. That's why I hate you so much. You're all I have, BB. Let's go. What? Why do you hate me? Philly blows. There isn't a more classless lot of turd people walking the earth than Eagles fans. Yeah. Straight men do this, but call us the F word for standing the pop girlies. Yeah, I mean, it's all the same shit. I've talked about this so many times. I'm on the let people live camp. You know what I mean? Philly Mongoast. Thank you for the 25 gifted subs. This man is just fucking peppering the gifties today. What the hell's going on? I make no mistake. I talk about this all the time. Like, sports fans and weebs are identical to one another, except, like, it's more normalized to be a sports fan. Okay. So the sports fan weeb-like behavior or sports weeb behavior is just, like, considered to be totally normal and valid and expected. But I am a firm believer in letting people enjoy things. So while I don't personally understand it, like, I love consuming the content. No, I'm not like this. I'm the one who's saying, shush, let people enjoy things. Oh, hey, you watch some sports ball? How's the stupid sport? Like, I'm not like that at all. I like being a part of the fun. Does that make sense? I like being a part of the fun, and I like making fun of the people that are, like, sad or happy. You know, that's it. But, like, I understand the concept of consumption. Bandwagon? What do you mean? You made fun of the Eagles fans eating shit? You're that guy? Brother, I'm sorry to tell you this, okay? I'm sorry to tell you this. But the entire continental United States and perhaps everyone around the world that knows about Philadelphia knows that Philly fans eat horse manure. So you're not really singling anybody out when you say stuff like that, okay? That's just, you know, you do that one time, you're known for it forever, okay? You do that one time, one guy one time, that's all your city's going to be known for, okay? It's just how it goes. You can't be like, dude, think about all the times I haven't murdered motherfuckers. No, you murder someone, you're a murderer, okay? That's how this works. You can't unmurder it, just like that guy can't uneat the shit that he ate, the horse shit. So, sorry, that's just how it is. You could try to be like, oh, dude, you're being just like the not letting people enjoy things guy by not letting him eat the poo-poo, but it's just he ate it, so... Fix 1,000 locks, you might not get called a locksmith. Suck one dick and you're gay. Exactly. That's collective punishment for the city? Brother, you live in Philadelphia. That's collective punishment in and of itself, okay?
First player to win MVP, Super Bowl MVP, and the Super Bowl in the same season since 1999. After the game, he made sure to praise...
It's a common understanding among sports fans talk that you cannot shit on teams openly while not repping a team yourself. I mean, I'm doing it, and I don't care. I love being a bandwagon Los Angeles sports fan, okay? It's the best. It's the most LA thing you can do, not giving a single shit about any sports whatsoever because this is a city full of fucking transplants, okay? And the one time, yeah, I'm a LA fan, and I love playing the stereotype, like playing into the role. The one time I went and watched a professional NFL game was when it was the Super Bowl last year with the Rams. That's it. That literally is like, there's no perfect demonstration of like how much of a LA sports fan I am. That's it. Anyway. That's all it takes. You're a team repper now. You can shit freely. Yeah, there you go. And I'm untouchable because you can't shit on me. I'm untouchable because like, oh, are you going to shit on the Rams? Oh, no. I am so offended. Okay? I'm not. I don't give a shit. Yeah, they suck. Who cares? Or they're good. I don't know. I don't know. Don't care.
His opponent, Jalen Hurts, who himself was reflective after the loss, saying you either win or you learn. Michael?
Yeah, you know, he's the first guy to do that since 1999. My old teammate, Kurt Warner, actually did it when he was playing for the St. Louis Cardinals. And, you know, what a game last night. He's right. Jalen Hurts had a great game as well. I think all football fans are just happy that it is one of these games that lived up to all the hype, Will. But thank you for
Anyway, here we go. We got Charlie talking about, was the Super Bowl rigged? I love this. I love his perspective on this. I don't even know what he's going to say, but this is the Norman guy. So I love, this is what I would look like if I was a sports fan, dude. If I was engaging in like heavy sports betting and had a team that I really loved, that's what I would look like.
I don't usually post a video this late into the evening, but right now I'm like a movie theater toilet. I am fuming. I am absolutely steaming because of how the Super Bowl just ended. I watch every Super Bowl, and in this one I didn't really have a horse in the race. I'm neither a Chiefs nor Eagles fan. I just wanted to be entertained. And for the majority of the game, I was thoroughly entertained. It was just a...
What is he a fan of? He's in Florida. It can't be like... He's a Buccaneers fan. What is he? What is he? Wait. Oh, he is? He's a Dolphins fan? I can't tell if you guys are fucking around or not. Jaguars? He ain't from the Tampa area. He's a centrist. He could mean a fan of the sport. No, he definitely is a great game.
Both teams putting on an incredible performance, going wacko mode, insano style, tying it 35-35. And just like the first Spider-Man movie when he fought Bonesaw, when Bonesaw was ready, we had 3 minutes. 3 minutes of playtime, and it was coming down to the wire, an absolute ass greaser. The Chiefs were driving down the field. They make it to the red zone. It's getting a little dicey for the Eagles. Fans spilling their beer all over themselves in anticipation and fear, but the Eagles are putting up an incredible defensive stand. And then in the most crucial moment of the entire game, with less than 2 minutes remaining in this tie game, a penalty was called for holding against the Eagles, which lost them the game. One single bad call decided the outcome of the Super Bowl at the very end, which is what has led the majority of people who watch this game to call rigged, say the refs are all paid off, and say that it's all just part of the script. Because right now there's a tinfoil nipple clamp conspiracy theory that floats around that a lot of people genuinely believe that sports are rigged. Or rather scripted. I actually do agree that there is rigging to a certain level with the refs. I do think there is real corruption there, but let me just opine on the scripting thing real quick. I think that's a load of dirty barnacles.
Dude, yeah. Terrible take. You think it's scripted? What are you, fucking insane? Come on, guys. It's been proven. Okay. Yeah, I don't believe it. Dude, come on. God, everyone is, I'm not going to touch this because people take it too seriously and they don't just think about it like it's like content to consume. This is their religion. It's their way of life. So
I think that is just a fat load of fish paste. I don't think sports are scripted at all. That's kind of an unhinged belief.
Yeah, I mean, this is probably the best explanation. Him saying, I pulled on his jersey, they called it, I was hoping they would let it ride. But also, it's more fun to say he's in on it. You know what I mean? It's more fun to say he's in on it instead of saying that, like, you know, this is probably what happened and the expectation was... The expectation from him was that, like, it's okay to not. To prove. People are starting to believe the scripting more because of this. Bro, this is obviously a fucking joke. No one took this seriously, I hope. Like, no. Actually, that's not even true. Yeah, you're right. People did take this seriously on Twitter. I watched the video. It's, you know, friends of the show, PFT, and Arian Foster having a conversation about how, like, it was scripted. And I think on Twitter, people did take it fucking seriously. No, so many people literally were like, dude, Arian, watch out. Like, they're coming for you. They're going to fucking, Roger Goodell's going to put a hit out on you, blah, 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 blah. Like literally people. Silken Cookies, thank you for the 50 gifted subs. It's crazy that, like, people on Twitter legitimately looked at that video and thought, you know, actually, yeah, he's right. Arian Foster's, like, not memeing, but very seriously whistleblowing on the NFL being scripted.
But I do think the refs are corrupt. It's not just football. It's basketball as well. This entire year has really shown me, since I got back into watching sports live, I have seen so many awful officiating moments that I can find no other explanation besides just malicious corruption. And this is the most blatant example. The holding call, I can't show you any clips because obviously it's the fucking Super Bowl. If I even showed you a still image of it, I'm sure Roger Goodell of the NFL would come to my house personally and fucking slap me around.
Philip Mongos, thank you for the 50 get the subs. They sent Robert Kraft over to get it.
A fucking sledgehammer. So I can't show you anything, but if you watch the Super Bowl, you immediately know the call. The call was on the Eagles for holding. The receiver was going out, and the Eagles defender lightly touched him, like, on the hip. It was a light touch and, like, a slight jersey tug that could have even been, like, accidental. It was so gentle. Like, the way he treated the receiver is the way a mother would treat a newborn baby. It was so light and caring. There was no holding at all on the play. And Patrick Mahomes threw up a stinky meatball of a pass that was just uncatchable regardless for the receiver that it was intended for. But they still threw the flag and called holding on the Eagles, which gave the Chiefs a first down and also just gave them plenty of time to run out the clock, kick a field goal, win the game. It was decided by that call. It was the most crucial moment of the game, and the call instantly ended it pretty much on the spot. And under no circumstances is that acceptable. Regardless of what team you are rooting for, I'm sure all of us can recognize that this is a complete wet fart of an ending to an otherwise amazing game.
This sounds like the recount of a game without the written consent of the NFL, Charlie. You'll be hearing from our lawyers. It seems like you're recounting the big game, which I apologize for using the actual term Super and Bowl together. Oh, fuck, I did it again. But it seems like you're talking about the big game. I don't know if anybody allowed you to do that.
Weird. Just got the bad ending to this one, unfortunately. The biggest sporting event that America has to offer is decided by the refs instead of the players. That's pathetic. That's awful. In a situation like this, I think they should go to the replays and be 100% sure that there is truly a penalty worthy of being called in a situation like this. It's a terrible look for the sport, and it's embarrassing overall.
Also, we're not done yet with the DMCA saga of Superb Owl, because, like, on the one hand, they are some of the most litigious in the entire field. On the other hand, there are brave, revolutionary IP pirates out there doing the utmost, doing everything they can to just abolish IP laws at kick.com, which we're going to be talking about. That's right. I'm talking about Trainwrecks and also Aiden motherfucking Ross. We're going to get to that in a second.
They should have 100% held the refs to a higher standard here. Oh, we're under 2 minutes to play, and this call is going to decide the outcome of the game. Everyone knew it. The second that call was made, even the commentators were like, oh, I don't agree with that one. Eek. That's a bit spicy. That's a no good. We don't like that. The commentators were outspoken about how bad the call was. In a situation where it is that crucial, they need to go back to the drawing board, check everything, and 100% be sure that this is a call that needs to be made. Because in this situation, it wasn't. It's a bad call. It's just straight up a shitty call. Even if you're the biggest Chiefs fan in the world, you got your Chiefs butt plug dialed all the way up to maximum turbo settings. It's vibrating in your colon. You're super excited they won. In the back of your mind, you know that it's a pretty upsetting ending. I'm sure you would have preferred if they had actually beat them on their own merit instead of having the refs help. Because no matter how you spin it, that call decided that game at the very end. The Chiefs could have still 100% won that, but now
even I understand that it's like, you guys are saying it's textbook holding, but even I fucking understand that he's saying, and everyone is saying that it's not just like that it is definitely a holding call, but it's one that, like, they enforced in that circumstance when they hadn't enforced it in prior circumstances. Therefore, like, people were expecting leniency at the very least. That's what the point is, right? That's what everyone is saying that they're upset about. And they're mostly upset about the fact that, like, a call from a referee leading to the game-winning kick is never going to be as satisfying. So people are just mad that it was, you know, it wasn't like as satisfying as an ending as it was supposed to be. Even though the defender himself said that, like, it was a weaker hold, or that he actually did hold, but he didn't think that the ref would, clap him on it.
Now it's always going to be left up to speculation on, well, would the Eagles have made a game-winning drive? Would the Eagles have stopped them on that red zone drive? Like, there's so many question marks now that the win can't feel as good as it would have if the refs didn't make that call. It's a lose-lose for everybody except the refs that may have been paid off. Like, I'm actually starting to believe that they are influenced in some way financially in order to make these awful calls. We just saw it recently in the NBA with the infamous no call against the Lakers. I'm not even going to bother going down that road right now. I already fucking ranted about that on stream for quite some time, and I'm not even a goddamn Lakers fan either. I just hate how awful calls decide the outcome of the biggest games. I just think that's horrible. Like, it's just bad. And what's even worse is there's really no incentive to be good at your job as a referee. Like, if you do well, cool. If you do poorly, there's no repercussions. Like, some of the worst refs of all time are still currently refs. Like, at the biggest, highest stage. I don't understand why they have so much leniency in situations like this, and so much power, too. This is a call that should have been thoroughly looked under with a microscope 1,000 times. Bring in a third-party investigation unit for this call tonight. Like, have them double check. Bring out a fucking forensics team. I don't care. It's the biggest call of that game in the most crucial moment of the entire game. Really do your due diligence to ensure that call is legitimate and necessary, because you do not want a game to wrap up the way this one did. It causes nothing but turmoil.
The UFC is bad. Patty should not have won last fight. Okay, well, I think that what a lot of people are failing to recognize in that situation is that sometimes you're going to have some favorites that are very marketable. Some of the best fighters, unfortunately, don't have that kind of charisma. So that's what happens sometimes, okay? That was like universal. I didn't even watch that fight, and I only saw universally everybody basically saying, like, you know, Patty should not have won that, but he is a very charismatic person that you can sell tickets around, and it gets a lot of attention. It gets a lot of eyeballs onto the sport. Anyway, I love watching everybody get excited and upset and do conspiracy theories around this stuff. Maybe it's because I'm just like on the outside peering in. So for me, it's nothing. It's like meaningless. You know what I mean?
Turmoil, and it ruins the entire thing. The Super Bowl was amazing all the way up until it wasn't, at the very last 2 minutes, less than 2 minutes. It's craziness. Can't believe I'm actually making a sports ranting video, but my family and I were having so much fun watching the Super Bowl, and when that call was made, collectively, all of us let out an audible groan in frustration, and it took the wind out of all of our sails. None of us are Chiefs fans or Eagles fans. We didn't give a fuck who won. It was just such an amazing game, and to have it in this way is deflating. I can only imagine Philadelphia Eagles fans right now. But anyway, I just wanted to vent about all this. Also, I'll tackle one more thing that I've already seen pop up a lot, where it's like, no, it's technically a holding no matter what. I just disagree. Like, even with the way the rule's written and the way that it's typically enforced, it still doesn't seem like a hold. His movement really wasn't impeded at all, and the ball was still pretty uncatchable anyway, so it's not like it would have had a huge impact on the outcome of that play in particular. So even if you want to argue that technically it's a hold, it's still a call that doesn't need to be made, especially given the magnitude of the game, because that call ends the game on the spot when you make it. This was the most important moment of the game. This was pivotal, and that call being made instantly decides the outcome of the entire game. Their fate was sealed the second they threw that penalty. So I don't think that it needed to be made. nor should it have been, because I don't think any games should be decided by a penalty like that. It's fucking pathetic. It's laughable, really. And that's why a lot of people are screaming rigged, because it did decide the winner of this match. No matter how you argue it, they won immediately off of that call. So it's just a real shame. And yeah, I just kind of wanted to talk about all of that. That's about it. See ya.
An emotional night.
I love not having any stake in this and any dog in this fight and just hitting the argument from both angles, because I'm seeing so many people get mad at Charlie being like, he doesn't know anything he's talking about. And I'm like, same. Speak it, brother. Speak it, sister. I don't fucking know. Sure. You know what I mean? Sure. You got it. It's just, it's fun. It's fun for me to just like finally be on the outside looking in and just like not having a dog in the fight at all, not having a stake at all. Yeah, it's like the YouTuber drama. Exactly. It's the YouTuber drama. I love it. It's awesome.
Night in Arizona.
What? What the fuck? Wait. No. What? Yo. Yo. That's crazy, dude. What the fuck? Bro. He's crying because he read the script right before he came out on the field, dude. It's real. The scripting is real. He knows. He's like, I can't. He's sitting there. He just read the script. He knows that it's going to be a referee call that basically eviscerates their chances. You know what I mean? And he's just like, fuck. I wish I could tell everybody.
Waterworks for Eagles head coach Nick Sirianni during the national anthem. An immediate win for the internet. Me knowing I have to go to work tomorrow. Me at the end of The Last of Us on HBO episodes 3 and 5. And more tears for Jason Kelce and Mama Donna after the Eagles' loss. But after the Chiefs' win, Travis getting that same support from Mom. The night's big loser, the grass at State Farm Stadium. Players slipping and sliding all night long. And the biggest winners of the night, Rihanna fans, a.k.a. the Navy. Cara Delevingne on the sidelines in a shirt that said Rihanna concert interrupted by a football game. Weird, but whatever.
Bro, she is so... God. Sorry, if you think that that's a fire shirt, you're so lame, okay? That is so fucking lame, dude. It's Rihanna. Like, she's already cool as fuck. How do you make being a fan of Rihanna look lame, dude? Oh my god. Ay, ay, ay. It's just like, stop. I'm not mad that she fucking curved me on Raya, okay? That's so... Everybody chill out, okay? Everybody fucking calm down. It you know, the Lord works in mysterious ways, okay? My lack of Riz in that particular moment helped me dodge a bullet, so shut the fuck up.
Game. Weird, but whatever. Yellow diamonds in the light, and we're standing side by side. Riri finding love high above the field in Super Bowl 57. Pay me what you want it. Don't act like you forgot. Unlike the half.
I heard someone was saying, some comedian was saying that, like, Rihanna showed that women don't deserve pregnancy leave, like, maternally. Rihanna proving that women don't need, a leave of absence from work for pregnancy. It's true. Look at that. If Rihanna can do it, why can't you?
Time shows in recent years, Rihanna's was a one-woman show. Sort of. Riri revealing a baby bump, simultaneously announcing a pregnancy, and becoming the first pregnant woman to headline the halftime show ever. The father of Rihanna's 9-month-old son, ASAP Rocky, cheering Riri on from the field. and Adele in the...
What the fuck is bro wearing, though, dude? Done. Oh, I mean, I can't talk. I mean, this is like, this is definitely some shit I would wear, okay? That's definitely some shit I would definitely... Okay, that is 100% something I would wear. I'm sorry. Yes, dead to rights. You can make fun of me for my instant reaction being, what the fuck's he wearing? I quickly owned it. I quickly owned it. I owned it. I owned it. I owned it. It's true. I would wear that.
ASAP Rocky cheering Riri on from the field. And Adele in the stands giving a meme-worthy reaction from her seat as per usual. And the halftime show's ASL interpreter, Justina Miles, going in.
Why people need to stop. I'm going to say it again. Riri! The ASL interpreter going in to Riri. She's serving up. She ate and had all the bread crumbs and left nothing.
A winning night for video gamers, too. Those floating platforms strikingly similar to Super Smash Brothers. Fans photoshopping Bowser and other characters into Rihanna's high-flying set.
Patty Moe got Kelsey's, a shout-out on mainstream news.
Brotherly support.
One brother scores, the other brother having a snack. Enjoy.
Jason Kelce unbothered when Travis Kelce scored for the Chiefs. Relatable, though. Game day really is all about the snacks and the ads.
What are you doing here?
I haven't seen a single fucking ad from the Super Bowl, by the way. I suspect there wasn't a lot of cryptocurrency ones, though. Hassan, no, the Hive, stop. What? Apparently, there were some Jesus ads, which I love. I love Jesus. By the way, she was quick. Her first baby was born May 2022.
Curse me if I like
Is this
friends.
What you do when you say you're going to work all day?
I gotta go, guys.
Grab me a glaze.
Ben and Jen for Dunkin' and more superstar commercials. Zoolander, aka Ben Stiller for Pepsi Zero.
This is really, really ridiculously good tasting.
Cher Horowitz, aka Alicia Silverstone for Rakuten.
I used to be pretty clueless about shopping. Like when I heard I could save by getting cash back with Rakuten, I was like, as if.
And movie fans getting a sneak peek of the final Guardians of the Galaxy.
I'm Star-Lord.
The upcoming Flash movie.
Bruce, I could fix things. You can also destroy everything.
And Indiana Jones.
What are you doing here?
Rescue you!
Hey,
bro, it's kind of wild, like, that DC basically was just like, as a franchise, we have to keep going with Ezra Miller. Like, and they're going to get away with it, I think. 100%. Like, they were just like, fuck it, YOLO, you know? Just, who cares, right? It is a wild play, but also, simultaneously, I'm like, I'm interested to see if they can get away with it. Like, does a big-budget Hollywood production have the capacity to get someone out of prison, okay? Help them evade the law regularly as they're doing, like, weird cult shit, okay? It's just, I don't know. I don't know. It's pretty wild. Is this even a question in your mind? Well, yeah, because, you know, when you are routinely being a menace to society, okay? Like, very openly being a menace to society, like, doing a lot of crimes which involve, like, kidnapping minors and stuff. Yeah, that's usually when you're like, okay, maybe we shouldn't continue with this person. It's like a liability. But, I mean, Armie Hammer got fucking, you know, Armie Hammer's gone, you know? Think about that. But I guess Armie Hammer wasn't like DC wasn't a part of, like, you know, DCIP, right? Hassan pro cancel culture. Okay. My friend, you have to understand, like, there's cancel culture, which is not real, which, by the way, this story perfectly demonstrates. And then there's, like, a federal crime cancellation, right? Which is called, like, doing crimes and then going to jail for doing crimes, right? Like that's just, we need to understand something about, like, cancel culture. It's like when you get canceled for doing something that is illegal by going to prison and serving a prison sentence. So there's a difference there. Zoomers, prison is kind of like cancel culture. You know, there's, like, rules and stuff that's, like, written. Anyway, that was, yeah. Zoomers are like, wow, they really canceled Ted Bundy. Exactly. Yeah. Fired Henry Cavill, but kept Ezra Miller. Can't make this shit up. Yeah, Henry Cavill got fucked a lot over a DCIP. Like, he quit. He publicly quit The Witcher. He publicly quit The Witcher franchise. Only to you know, do Superman, and then he got fucking, you know, clapped up. It's wild. It's a recent movie. That's the whole point of doing the Flashpoint story here, so they can start over. Okay, but, like, you're not hearing me. Dude, you're not... Like, that doesn't change the... Dude, I don't care. What? It's like, you don't get it. It's a reset movie. Okay, well, so, like, Ezra Miller, like, they have to be in the movie so they can reset the lore. What? DC stands like, we really need this IP reset, okay? The last couple of franchise hits have been dog shit. We forcibly brought back the fucking Zack Snyder cut, which was also dog shit, okay? We need this reset really bad. You don't understand. I don't give a fuck if Ezra Miller is openly sacrificing babies on camera. We need this reset for the franchise. If you want to reset the top of the hour ad break and no longer see it, though, all you need to do is subscribe at the top of the hour, because there's a 3-minute ad break coming now. Now, of course, everyone wants an uninterrupted broadcast experience, like the DC fans want a reset to their franchise. You're joking, but that's exactly what it is. No, I know. It's not even a joke. It's real, just like the top of the hour ad break is, which you can, you know, make it surreal as long as you subscribe for $5 or for free with a Twitch Prime or by getting gifted a sub. Run the ad break, Bish. Thank you for the 5 gifted subs, allowing 5 people to no longer see the ads. I will be running the ad break now. There it is. Oh, yeah, yeah. Nancy's Pelosi's. Thank you for the 5. Get the subs. I want to reset so goddamn bad. Tired of DC getting shit on by normies who don't read. Bro, you're talking about reading a comic book. Blast is safe. Thank you for the 5. Get the subs.
Ooh, I'm so excited for Phoebe Waller-Bridge in that. It was also a winning night for volunteers, a team from the Food Recovery Network, working overnight to make sure the leftover food from State Taboo. Farm Stadium, items like cheeseburgers, chicken wings, and fresh seafood
lady,
doesn't go to waste.
This
year,
five,
the team
the
of
subs.
Volunteers bringing the thousands of pounds of leftovers to the Phoenix Rescue Mission.
Love that. That's and really I know awesome. That Patrick Mahomes is going to Disneyland. I prefer Disney World because I'm really trying to get on that new Tron ride at Epcot. Oh.
Bamboy Disney X9, World thank always. You for the 5 gifted. Yeah, yeah, yeah. They're going to Disneyland, of course. Okay, so Rihanna did a halftime show. I didn't watch it. People are saying she was wonderful. I love Rihanna. I'm sure she was wonderful, okay? Philemon Ghost, thank you for the 10 gifted subs. So, you know, I don't really care about it too much. Like, should we watch the whole thing? Like, yeah, it looks like, Super Smash Bros. Like, it looks like a stage like that. The only thing I do care about the Rihanna performance is that, I mean, she's like, first of all, she is, you know, she's like visibly pregnant, you know, good on her for, being able to pull through. It's cool. People were saying, like, other than the stands, people were saying that it was mid overall. It was pretty decent, but not just lots of old music. I mean, she has an insane catalog. So, it's just not, like, she has an incredible catalog. An incredible backlog, you know what I mean? So, it's gonna be good regardless, even if she plays her old hits. Like, so, it's the Super Bowl, not a concert for a new album. Yeah, I mean, whatever. ASAP Rocky's sperm on their way to stop Rihanna from releasing that album. Wait, what? Top five most selling artists of all time. XC has a crazy take on the...
Dude, fuck off, man. Bro.
What? Bro, I can't even... What's the take? There. Wow, he's brilliant. My juicer. Here was a take. Special envoy for combating anti-Semitism and delegitimization of Israel, Noah Tishby. Let's hear what she had to say.
Okay, so I have a thought, and I'm not going to make too much of a fuss out of it because it's just not going to help, but...
But I'm going to say it. Okay, let's hear it.
Rihanna has so many hit songs. Did she have to do a Kanye song? Did she have to? Because... The thing is that if a pop artist would have
said sweaty, that pop off. Yeah, it's not allowed. It's not allowed. So fucked up. Did she have to do a Kanye? Did she have to do a Kanye song? Isn't it her? I mean, what song did she? I don't even know which song she's talking about. Is it, what is it? All of the Lights or whatever? Is that the one? That's the one she's talking about? Yeah, I mean, who cares?
On three, on any other ethnicity, let alone everything else that he said, they would have been canceled and not played on the Super Bowl. That's that. So, yeah, again, Jews don't count. They just don't.
Yeah, totally. That's that, yeah. Showing this is anti-Semitism. Candace Owens' take, how conservatives lose culture. Nothing wrong with Rihanna's performance, but finding things wrong anyway. Dude. Conservatives need to just, like, turn the fucking TV off, man. I mean, actually, I don't want them to do that because, like, it's really funny. I love when conservatives pop off about this shit, okay? I love when conservatives pop off about this shit because, like, they just come across as, like, so unhinged whenever they're, like, satanic pedophiles. Rihanna was doing satanic sacrifice on the stage. Like, I hate that. Bro, Aiden's chat on Kick is straight fascism. Yeah, no shit, guys. What the fuck do you think was gonna happen? Elon Musk is a Elon Musk successfully one cursed the Eagles and then deleted the tweet to hide the evidence that he cursed the Eagles, by the way. Really fucked up shit. But also pretty funny that he like it pretty funny that he deleted it afterwards. We'll get to Elon Musk's inside information in that saga in a second. There's a lot going on inside of Twitter, apparently. So we will be talking about that as well. But yeah. He was hanging out with Rupert Murdoch. Yeah. Oh, fuck. Before I forget, here is Elon Musk hanging out with Rupert Murdoch. Big hater of like big media, by the way. I love when Elon Musk, like, who is so desperate for any kind of affection he can get from the right wing for some fucking reason, is out there hanging out, constantly fucking talking about like, oh, the media is this, the media is that. Meanwhile, he is next to the media guy. This is the media god. What Ben Shapiro said for the Super Bowl. All right, we'll watch that in a second. The announcers call Elon Musk and Rupert Murdoch brilliant, then immediately declare why they called Murdoch brilliant. Good to know the owner of this platform is hobnobbing the head of a right-wing propaganda machine, politically independent or fascist.
Brilliant minds in that photo. Rupert Murdoch, Elizabeth Murdoch, Elon Musk. Rupert pays our checks, too, so that's always good.
Huh. Brilliant minds over there, Rupert Murdoch.
But yeah, everyone take it in Super Bowl 56. Well,
you know, look who Murdoch's best friend is. What is this? Oh, Ghislaine Maxwell. Yeah, I mean, that's not a big surprise. Ghislaine Maxwell is the daughter of a media giant in the UK. Obviously, the dick riding disclosure statements is what 2023 needed. Yeah. James Murdoch, Robert Murdoch's son, sits on the board of directors at Tesla. That's very nice. There was a really bad Greg Gutfeld commercial, apparently. So that's cool. The thing is, like, disgusting. No other words to describe. Shameful display of Satan's effect on our young people. I call this satanic slut fest. So, the thing is, like, these guys rarely ever consider like big media figures to be satanic if they're like right wing. So I'm on board. I hope that they finally recognize that Elon Musk is satanic and it's not like Rihanna or whatever the fuck that is actually satanic. Charlie Kirk suggests there may be a false flag operation to fake an alien invasion. We're gonna get to that in a little bit. The Pat Tillman thing was crazy. I guess like I'll briefly give you the Pat Tillman saga real quick. Oh, this was awesome. Donald Trump apparently hates Rihanna for no reason. I don't even know what the fuck the reason is. But even before the Super Bowl, Trump attacks Rihanna ahead of Super Bowl, says, without her stylist, she'd be nothing. And I don't know who he's referring to as far as like her stylist. I don't know if he knows who Rihanna's stylist is. I don't know if he's like joking, saying like ASAP Rocky is her stylist, maybe. Like, he's like, I freed him. I think like he wanted to use her music or something in his rallies, and then she wouldn't allow that, so he's just like been holding on to it. And of course, he gives another halftime response. Epic fail Rihanna gave, without question, the single worst halftime show in Super Bowl history. This after insulting far more than half of our nation, which is already in serious decline with her foul and insulting language. Also, so much for her stylist. It's awesome. He's just partaking in the national pastime of shitting of women and women of color. That's not the real one. Okay. Epic. Rihanna gave, without question. It's just like, I love this shit because he's so petty. He's so catty. He's so sassy. This is without a doubt Trump at his finest. Okay. Cultural critique, commentary on whatever is going on in the world in like the bitchiest, most petty way possible is he tries to like tie a personal grievance that he has with that particular person to like a larger association that like the American right has with this person. So I love that. He also, on top of that, called Ron DeSantis Meatball Ron, which is Italiophobia, and I am totally on board with it. If you remember, I made other anti-Italian sentiments that I expressed. I said that, like, he should start, like, saying that Ron DeSantis is, like, greasy, you know what I mean? Things of that nature. And I'm glad that Trump is, like, finally fucking pulling out the zingers. Yeah, here it is. Trump has insulted Mr. DeSantis in casual conversations, describing him as Meatball Ron, an apparent dig at his appearance. It's good. When is Ron going to hit back? He can't. Ron DeSantis can't hit back. Have you seen this clip about Ron, by the way? Oh, dude. Oh, my God. So much fun shit happened while I was not live that I wanted to, like, desperately cover. Okay. Like, this guy. Okay. Oh, my fucking God. Hez Bolsonaro had a really good tweet on this, and I'm gonna show you guys that too. This is fire, okay? Evangelical alert. New evangelicals defending Ron DeSantis alert. Now, you might think, like, what the fuck's going on here? There's a bucket right there, okay? That is just product placement. For those of you who don't understand this culture, right-wing evangelicals have these, like, television shows that are broadly circulated. A lot of people watch it. And they make money selling you the idea first that, like, you know, God is coming to punish you, Y2K is happening, and then tell you you can fucking survive it, you know, by eating the bucket when this shit happens, when this shit inevitably pops off, basically. Okay? Big fan of all that. Love it personally. Big fan. Please, more of this. Let's take a look.
We need to watch Ron DeSantis. Because the Lord is going to use him in a powerful way. Mm. I had several years ago a vision that I went into where I saw two palm trees. And I saw one of them was planted in California, the other one in Florida. And I said, Lord, what is these two palm trees? He said, this palm tree from California is Ronald Reagan. This palm tree that is in Florida is Ron DeSantis. Mm. He said, Ron DeSantis or Ronald.
This guy looks like a Fortnite skin. He looks like Cypher PK's Fortnite skin, specifically.
DeSantis is the...
Like, no disrespect to the homie. I love him, but like...
Second has an anointing similar to Ronald Reagan. And I saw...
He looks like Caucasian Hasan Minhaj. Oh my God. Oh, that's so good.
Ron DeSantis as a tree of righteousness, that palm tree.
Bro, he looks like he went to one of those, like, you know, Indian Instagram barbers. You know what I'm talking about? Where, like, they pull out like a fucking weird ruler, like a shaper. And just go, vroom. You know what I'm talking about? Like, he literally went to some, like, crazy fucking Indian Instagram barber, and they blowtorched the half of his fucking face. This is the, first of all, someone else also called it out. I was just about to say this. This is the most Persian-coded man I've ever seen, okay? There is no shot. This dude is white, okay? He sounds white. He looks white. I've never seen a white guy with this fade. This is the most Muslim mena fade you can have, okay? This is literally every, like, Iraqi motherfucker. He is the most mena faded motherfucker I've ever seen, dude. This is crazy. Every Arab guy has that cut, that beard. Yes, 100%. It's so fucked up. He's Mexican-American, bro. Don't believe it.
And I saw it uprooted from Florida and brought to Washington, D.C. and planted in Washington, D.C. And as the storms came, he was not moved.
That's right.
There's something about Ron DeSantis that we need to begin to pray for, we need to begin to look at, because his ultimate future is to have a position in the United States as the president and be planted in Washington, D.C., and he would be like a Ronald Reagan.
Yeah. Mm.
Wow. Bro, come on, dog. I mean, come on, dude. Why is there 5-gallon kitty litter? It's what they sell. It's what they sell to their audience. First, they sell the idea of like Y2K happening, okay, because they've been bad, because like gay people exist or whatever. And then they tell them like when it does inevitably happen, you know, you can survive with this bucket of kitty litter that you eat. Yeah, they're apocalypse buckets for preppers. Weird that they have just a sizable audience of preppers, you know? I wonder where those ideas are coming from. I wonder why they're so invested in you know, doomsday shit. Bald guy is Jim Baker, in case you didn't know. So I love this. Like, I just don't believe that this guy believes anything he's saying. But it doesn't really matter because there are plenty in the audience that does, right? And Hez Bolsonaro actually had a pretty good tweet on this. He had a pretty good thread on this in general, where he was talking about how, like, he was basically talking about, like, how insane it is that, like, we exist together in the same fucking, together in the same country with someone like this. Hold on. Let me pull this shit up real quick. Where the fuck is it? God damn, this motherfucker tweets way too much. I'm trying to find it, and I can't. Oh, here it is. I thought this was a very good thread. It's so weird to think that there are probably like a million people that watch this, and I, you know, along with those people, come from the same country as them. They have familiar material trappings, but beyond that, they might as well be jungle tribesmen. It is such an alien culture. Like, we live in a country where people might as well be from a different planet, okay? Not even from, like, a tribal nation or something like that, like an indigenous population that was never, that never actually, you know, made contact with the modern world or whatever. They might as well be fucking from a different planet, okay? Think about that. There are millions of people that watch this shit and go, yeah, this is so real. Like, Ron DeSantis did come to this man in a dream. I'm not trying to do some like, haha, dumb, fundy Christians, I'm so much better and smarter than them thing. Just thinking about how foreign they are. Like, I see this and I'm like, you guys have eyeglasses and water bottles? Not evangelicals, but the biggest culture shock I ever had was in 2018 in my own home state, where I was wandering around Brooklyn and I turned a corner street to see entirety Hasidic Jews. Never felt more out of place in my life. And he said, good, this guy. It's like, America has so many interesting cultural enclaves and religious enclaves specifically that is like very purposely, like the Amish, Hasidic Jews, like ultra-Orthodox communities, and evangelical Christians especially unique, because like evangelical Christianity is quite literally baked into our culture. So you get to like interact with them more than you do with like Hasidic Jews or you know, some of the other like LDS cults, you know what I mean? LDS adjacent, like specific cults in Utah that you sometimes hear about in the news. So it's very interesting to see like how much these people have like, you know, an impact on American society when they are living, I feel like, in a different planet. You know? I read somewhere that about 40% of Americans don't believe in evolution, and it shook me to my core. My friend, what is it? 52% of Americans believe that Jesus Christ is going to come back. They believe in angels. It's more than that. A higher percentage of that believe in angels. A higher percentage of that literally believe that Jesus Christ is going to come back before 2050 and bring about the rapture. As I've said time and time again, this is another Hasanabi trope in this community. You can get 30% of Americans to believe in anything. Okay? On any poll, you can always find at least 30% of Americans to believe literally the most unhinged shit. That's it. So, I don't know. I don't know what to tell you. It's wild. And yeah, if you bring up Brazil when you're talking about like Americans, yeah, no shit. Brazil is America light. So of course, you know, there's a similar attitude there as well. Where does he talk about the Super Bowl halftime show? Is it here? Is he talking about the commercials? What's he talking about? I don't know if the conservatives made that big of a stink about the Super Bowl this time around.
Kind of strange, at least in the previews. Oh, here are the up. Oh, she's being followed. What is happening right now? Riveting. Now, to be fair, she couldn't dance last night. Up, oh, here we go. She's grabbing her a crotch, of course. This happened multiple times last night.
It's hard. It's got to be. Ben's job is hard. Ben's job is hard. He has to find something wrong with every Super Bowl halftime performance, unless it's like, I don't know, like a country singer who doesn't say anything sexual or whatever. So he's like literally hamming it up, okay? Like, ah, of course, she's holding her crotch. It's like, dude, this was probably the most like reserved halftime show in recent Super Bowl history. It was tame as fuck. Partially because Rihanna is, like, very pregnant. You know what I mean? And he's still like, no, unacceptable. I'm so mad. This is so frustrating.
Because she was pregnant, she was much more modest than women have been in the past on this show. And she's kind of barely bouncing around. My wife and I were laughing at this last night because my wife is 6 months pregnant. So apparently significantly more pregnant than Rihanna. So we're just imagining her doing these dances, which would have been hilarious. But she couldn't do much last night. I get it. I mean, she's pregnant. Now, I have to say, the NFL and she and her agent, they all knew she was pregnant before she did the show. I'm going to suggest that the reason they did not announce that until after the show is specifically because they knew that she was not going to be good. So if they had said before the show, by the way, Rihanna's pregnant, people would have been like, is it safe to put a pregnant lady on risers that are going like up 200 feet in the air with no guardrails? Like, is that like the best idea? And if they do it after the show, then that makes a good excuse for her not being very good last night with her COVID crew, her COVID cleanup crew last night. Here she was once again grabbing her crotch. There was a lot of crotch grabbage last night. It's still better than it had.
Bro, he is trying so hard. He's trying so hard.
He's been,
dude,
at the Super Bowl for quite a while because the Super Bowl has been kind of a center of Vegas-style degradation for a long time. She's the most clothed that any of these female pop stars has been for quite a while. Here she was doing some crotch grabbing, of course. She's grabbing her butt. And now She has a tail or something. There's the COVID crew.
That's so funny. He can't find anything. He's just, they're on autopilot, dude. They're on autopilot. He's like, yeah, it's Satan or whatever. Okay, she's grabbing her crotch. Vegas style degradation, he said.
Tons of kids who didn't watch the halftime show, they did.
I mean, I'm not even kidding. I think like Ben is more mad that it wasn't, hornier. One, because he secretly likes it. And two, because he can't complain about anything. So he's like, this sucks.
Millions of kids watched the halftime show. The NFL knows this. This was less offensive than most of the shows. And just on a pure aesthetic level, it's a bad show. On a pure aesthetic level, it was 20 minutes of the same thing over and over. And all of her songs, I hate to say it, they sound the same. They have no range. She can't sing. It's an unpopular thing, but that's what we do here on the Ben Shapiro Show. We have
What? Yo, that's okay. That's a wild take. Get his ass, Twitter, do your thing, okay?
Popular cultural opinions that are significantly more controversial, apparently, than like my opinions about politics, which is kind of amazing to me. But if I say two things, one, it's nice that she's pregnant, and two, she did a crap show last night, then everybody loses it. No, it was an amazing show, and you will love it. She's a beautiful woman of color who's pregnant. You will love that show. You will love it. And if you mention that it was a bad show and it was very unentertaining and incredibly boring, this is.
Dude, he's literally, okay, here's the funny thing. This betrays the argument that he constantly makes, which is that, like, you can't make, like, hypersexualized crazy displays because then he'll say it's satanistic, right, and perverted. But when you do a modest show as a consequence of your, like, pregnancy, a more modest show by every fucking measure, so modest that even Ben has to fucking recognize it, then it's like kind of boring, and he wants to say it's boring, but like also simultaneously, it's like, bitch, you want it to be boring, and when it's boring, you're like mad that it's boring. You can't win with these fucking freaks, dude. That's crazy. If it's interesting and crazy and you know, there's a lot of, like, these wild displays, then it's like, oh, well, you know what? It's fucked up. It's too horny. I don't like it. It's satanistic. They're perverting our children. You know, children should not be watching this. Okay? But when it's, like, modest, then he's like, well, it's modest because it's good. But also, she's pregnant, so it's kind of boring.
This is probably because you're some sort of bigot. I mean, pretty sure it's just because it was kind of a boring show. It's kind of boring. So, there is your breakdown. So, the Super Bowl overall, it wasn't like super duper woke. It wasn't as woke as it was in past years. It didn't even have the same level of controversy as it did last year when it was a bunch of rappers who actually had criminal histories.
That wasn't even controversial. Who gives a fuck? What? No. Who found that to be controversial? No one. Also, Super Bowl being woke is not necessarily controversial either. What the fuck?
Disney.
Bro, when he talks about, like, controversial rappers with criminal histories, he's talking about Snoop Dogg, Eminem, and Dr. Dre, by the way. Like,
worldwide.
What?
I like Disneyland a lot. We were annual pass members in my family, but I'm not willing to patronize the same people who then subsidize a bunch of wokesters to indoctrinate my kids. I'm not willing.
Okay. Anyway, love this. He's kind of bent that he can't really, like, go too crazy over it. As far as Pat Tillman goes, I have not listened to this podcast, but does anyone have the video of Pat Tillman? Wait, oh, fuck, did I? Hold on, let me just find it real quick. Yeah, Ben did say, Ben, who is also a classically trained musician, a violinist, said Rihanna is bad objectively from a music standpoint. No, not the Pat Tillman video I did. I want to find the, I also lost the Macy's fucking playlist. I deleted it. I turned it out. I can't even talk. I accidentally. Where the fuck's the playlist? God damn it. I want to see the ad from the foundation. Yes. When will we stop talking about Super Bowl? I mean, you know. Thank you, Weeby.